So, we've spent three lectures talking about many theoretical issues, review of old ideas, talking about some of the outstanding challenges, and all those things are very exciting and very important. But there's something else which is making the particular era that we're going through right now on the subject, of course, particularly exciting. And that is that we have finally entered a data-rich period in the development of our subject. Now, there's two senses in which this is true. There's a completely obvious sense that we're in an era now, finally, after 30 years, with lots of experimental data, new experimental data coming in. Most prominently from the Large Hadron Collider, which is what we'll spend some time talking about. So that's completely obvious and incredibly exciting and incredibly important. And again, we'll talk about it some. But there's another sense in which we're in a really data-rich period, which is a little bit less appreciated, but which I also find, and many of us also find, very exciting, which is that we're also in an era that's unusually rich in what I'd like to call theoretical data. By theoretical data, I mean that we have understood enough about we're starting to see more and more and more really extraordinary mathematical structures that underlie quantum field theory, which is this universal framework that puts together the 20th century ideas of space-time and quantum mechanics and lets us talk about them in a consistent manner. But we're learning more and more and more that this theoretical structure conceals in it some vast subterranean riches, and that we're probably very far from understanding really what it is. That the laws of relativity and quantum mechanics that were discovered in the 20th century allowed us to stumble onto this fantastic structure and start understanding certain things about it, but that's not the final word for what this actual object is and what the set of ideas really are. And we're starting to see enough into the heart of what's concealed in this structure, just theoretically, lots of theoretical data that we can start trying to understand and analyze, and it may lead us to a deeper understanding of where space-time and quantum mechanics come from. It's certainly clear by now that the usual way of formulating what quantum field theory is, which we teach in textbooks correctly and you will learn in your courses, and it's perfectly beautiful and fine, that this is not remotely the final word on what is really in this structure. And there are so many hints of something really, really remarkable going on that we can actually follow and explore that this is another thread, another set of developments that I think quite complementary to this one, although there are some relationships, perhaps, that I think is going to lead to lots of interesting developments in the next 10 or 20 years. But let's first spend some time talking about the most obvious sense in which we're in a data-rich era, which is from new experiments. So I want to spend some time talking about the LHC. Probably many of you have seen talks about the LHC, so I won't spend a long time talking about all of the various details that go along with this fantastic facility, but we cannot resist showing pictures like this and talking a little bit about what it actually is. So this is an aerial view outside Geneva. There's the Alps in the background. That's Lake Geneva. There's a Geneva airport. And of course, from the sky, you don't see this big red oval on the ground. But around 100 meters underneath where that oval is a tunnel. And in that tunnel, there's a beam pipe. This whole gadget is around 27 kilometers in circumference. And in that beam pipe, there are protons accelerated one way around the ring to astonishingly high energies, another way around the ring to astonishingly high energies, and at a number of places around the ring, they're brought into collision with each other, and we study the debris of those collisions. So that's what it looks like inside, inside the ring. You see 27 kilometers is a long way, so you can barely detect the curvature, but you can kind of see it. The LHC is famously a very, very important international collaboration. Many, many countries around the world. Everything associated with this experiment has some superlative associated with it. It's the largest experiment in human history as far as the actual scale, sort of size of the machine, the size of the detectors that we'll talk about, the sheer number of people who work on it. So there's a number of experiments going on at the LHC, but for the ones that are of particular interest to this talk, and to many of us in high-energy physics, there's two groups of roughly 3,000 people each working on two experiments. So the scale is completely unprecedented in every way. Of course, it's impossible not to notice that the distribution isn't as uniform as it should be around the world. And this is one of the things that we really have to do a lot and focus very hard on repairing. And this is one of the things that the ICTP is doing such a great job with, but we evidently also have a ways to go. But still, it's wonderful to see in this day and age cooperation across the entire world for fundamental questions. Okay, so now enough of fancy pictures. Let's go back to my pictures. Okay, so this is another snapshot of what the LHC does. So here's a proton. There's a proton. Remember, the protons are around 10 to the minus 14 centimeters big. And each one of them is accelerated around this ring to around 0.9999999. So that's seven nines times the speed of light. So that's an energy that's roughly 7,000 times the rest mass energy of the proton. Okay, so enormous, enormous energies. And they're accelerated to very high energies so that the collisions probe distance scales of roughly 1 over 1,000 TeV or so. That's this 10 to the minus 17 centimeter scale that we talked about. And if we look inside the proton with my magnifying glass, of course, the proton is made out of quarks and gluons. So what we're really interested in, well, most of the time, see, the proton is around 10 to the minus 14 centimeters big. So this is a gargantuan scale compared to the tiny distances that we want to probe. Most of the time, what happens when you take a big, messy bag of quarks and gluons and another big, messy bag of quarks and gluons, which are the protons, and you smash them into each other at very high energies? What do you think happens most of the time? The vast majority of the time, they just break apart into huge numbers of strongly interacting particles, and this big spray of mess goes down one way and goes down the other way in the direction in which the beams were coming. Okay? That's what happens the vast majority of the time. That's not what we're interested in. Some people are interested in that, and there are some interesting questions associated with how that happens. That's not what we're interested in for the rest of this talk, and that's not the sort of real purpose of the driving purpose of the LHC. The driving purpose of the LHC is to study the laws of nature at very short distances. And to do that, what happens a small fraction of the time is that some of these point-like quarks and gluons inside here collide with the point-like quarks and gluons inside there and have a head-on collision. Now, how do you know that this short-distance collision took place? Well, it's exactly the same way Rutherford knew that there was a hard core to the nucleus of the atom, and also exactly the way the people in the late 60s and early 70s at SLAC discovered that there was hard point-like constituents inside the proton, the quarks. You discover that because when you have these high-energy collisions, the particles that come out when there is a hard short-distance collision come out typically at large angles relative to the beam. Unlike what happens most of the time, which is they just break apart and go back and forth in the direction of motion. So that's the first kind of diagnostic that some kind of very short distance physics has taken place. And we hope something new happens. Of course, most of the time, standard physics happens. But we hope sometimes something new happens. And the something new will be, for example, the production of some new particles. Now, unfortunately, these particles don't come out wearing a name tag saying, I am a new particle. Take me to Stockholm. Okay. In fact, typically, they decay with a lifetime of order 10 to the minus 27 seconds. That's the light crossing time for 10 to the minus 17 centimeters. And they decay to ordinary particles that are, in the end, stable. So electrons, positrons, muons aren't stable in everyday life. A muon sitting here would decay very, very rapidly. But these muons are extremely boosted, and they are boosted enough that as far as any of the timescales that we're concerned here, the muons are also stable particles. Ordinary quarks and gluons can come out, and these quarks and gluons, again, we don't see individual quarks, but the quarks pick up gluons and quarks and anti-quarks out of the vacuum, and they turn into jets of strongly interacting particles that come out, and we can see. So that's what happens. We collide them. Every now and then, a small fraction of the time, we probe very short distance physics. And in order to figure out what happened, we have to study the decay products of whatever this new stuff was by surrounding this collision region with some big detectors and studying all the properties of the guys that come out. So the two experiments that we're interested in, ATLAS and CMS, have detectors that are these gigantic beasts that look like that. So let's look at a couple of them in turn. So that's the detector associated with the ATLAS experiment, one of the two experiments that's focused on the high energy physics processes at the LHC. And the scales are, I'm sure you've seen pictures like this before, but the scales are absolutely gargantuan. It's 45 meters long, 24 meters high. There's a couple of European Union issue human beings sitting there to give you an idea of scale, okay? And one of the beams comes in there, one of the beams comes in there, the collision takes place in there. We could give an entire series of lectures on how these incredible detectors are put together, but there is an onion-like layer that surrounds the interaction region, and the whole point is to just stop everything which is, study everything which is coming out, and try to understand as much as possible about what kind of particle is it. Is it strongly interacting, not strongly interacting? Is it charged? What is its energy? What is its momentum? So you can get as much data as you can about the things that are coming out and try to reconstruct something about what went in. Just a small point. It's an obvious point, but it's fun to think about. It is ironic that this experiment that probes the tiniest distances we've ever probed is the biggest experiment we've ever had. And all of this is a constant reflection of the uncertainty principle. Okay? Because we have to go to such short distances, we have to go to very high energies. To go to very high energies, we make these big rings and accelerate the particles around them gradually. Okay, we could make the rings smaller, but then it's harder to accelerate them because they radiate. So you got to make the ring big so that as you give it a kick and accelerate it, as you go around and around, it's possible to keep going so that you can get it to high enough interesting energies. So that's one fact already. The ring is so big because that's the only practical way we know of getting the particles up to enormous energies. Then we smash them into each other, and all these particles come out, and we want to study them. But because we have to go to such high energies to probe short distances to begin with, they come out with enormous energies. And one component of what makes these detectors so big is, for instance, you have to stop some of these particles. Just stopping some of these incredibly high-energy particles requires these enormous amounts of material just to be able to stop them. Okay? So There is a reason why these things are so big, and it's directly tied to the fact that we're probing very, very tiny distances with them, which is just kind of cool. Okay. There's also tons of little facts we could, as I said, it could be a whole lecture series just about how the LHC is put together, but just a few little fun facts as we go along. This giant contraption, if you threw it in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, it would float. There's a lot of air in it. Now, this is a picture of one of the early events. You see the time there. One of the early events at Atlas. And okay, looks like so the protons came in, another proton came in there. There was a collision, and this whole spray of particles is coming out. And it gives you an idea of how this onion-like structure around it captures everything, measures energy. You see some of these lines are curved because use magnetic fields to bend the tracks and get an idea of the charge and so on and so forth. Okay. That's another picture, more famous picture of the Atlas experiment with another European Union issue human being. Okay. All right, the second detector is the CMS detector. The C, this is the compact muon solenoid. The C stands for compact. See, it's so much smaller than Atlas. Teeny tiny thing compared to Atlas. There's another little guy, give you a scale. This does not float if you threw it in the Atlantic, okay? I'll just do one last whiz-bang thing about how these detectors work. Every element of this onion has a purpose in life, okay? So if we go down to very, very tiny distances right around where the first set of things, that particles that come out of the interaction region encounter very, very close in are strips of silicon like that. Okay? These beautiful strips of silicon which are used to be able to very, very accurately or as accurately as possible determine what the tracks of these of charged particles look like. Okay? So that's what it looks like, and that's exactly what it looks like inside your digital camera as well. Okay? It's just this is a much fancier version of how your digital camera works. Okay. Oh, sorry, I had one last whiz-bang thing to tell you, which is these are enormous experiments, and they are housed in enormous caverns underground. So this is a picture of what of the space in which CMS, the CMS detector sits. That's what it looks like before CMS was, the detector was lowered, and the detector was lowered very, very, very slowly and carefully down that hole so that it sat here at the end. Another little fact, just to give you an idea of the precision of these things. Our experimental colleagues are wonderful people. The precision with which these detectors have got to be engineered is at the millimeter level. Okay, so you really need you really want to know exactly millimeter scale. Errors are costly and can't be tolerated. So the detector had to have the property that when it was sitting finally at the bottom, it was nice and perfectly symmetrical at the millimeter scale. So when it was engineered to be a little bit oblate so that when it sagged under its weight, it sagged to be perfectly symmetrical at the millimeter level. I mean, people have to worry about stuff like that. I'm glad it's not me. Okay. Okay, so that means, you know, as theorists, since most of you here want to be theorists, we have a really awesome responsibility to make the most we can out of the data from this experiment because they've really gone to a lot of trouble. Okay. Okay. So, the big news of the last year is that the LHC operations are in full swing, and the machine is just performing spectacularly. I think it's performing better than even the experimentalists expected, certainly performing better than I as a theorist expected it to. And what we've learned from it, even up to now, exceeds by quite a bit my expectations for what we would have learned already. Already the data from the LHC is coloring significantly the way I think about the world, and I didn't expect that to happen at such an early stage with this run. Okay, but it really is. And there is just a massive amount of information that's being generated. There is a just to give you an idea, it's around a terabyte per second. This is a unit which I didn't know, a zettabyte. It's around 10 zettabytes a year is the total amount of information being processed by the LHC. And this is comparable to all the information everywhere else on the planet that's being processed at any given time. Okay, so like the entire Google database, okay, that's we're comparable amount of information just for the LHC all by itself. That's a great unit, a zettabyte, okay? An absolutely massive amount of information. And one reason that such a massive amount of information is there is that the actual rates of these collisions is so high. So let me just give you an idea. This is a cartoon. If experimentalists would just kill me if they saw that me representing this even as a cartoon for how new physics is discovered, okay? It's a drastic oversimplification, but it's good enough for this purpose, and it does illustrate how hard their life is. Okay, so just so you have an idea of the rates at which things are going to happen, there's around 1 billion collisions per second that happen at the LHC. Okay. Now, in 1994, 95. Somewhere in the mid-90s, the top quark was discovered at Fermilab. Okay. It was discovered, if I remember, with something like 14 top quark candidate events. Okay. So that was the big discovery of the 90s in particle physics, 14 top quarks. Okay. By now, we had many, many more than 14 top quarks at the Tevatron. But just so you have an idea, the rate for producing top quarks at the LHC is 10 top quarks a second. So it's this maxim in particle physics that yesterday's discovery is today's background and tomorrow's calibration, okay? And that's what we're at now. The top quarks are just nothing. They're 10 a second, okay? But let's talk about something new. For example, superpartners, squarks. If we're lucky and the squarks are out there and accessible, then the rate, just so you have an idea, the kind of rate at which they're being made is 1 a minute. Okay? So that's a nice human time scale. Maybe it'll be 1 an hour. Okay? It's a nice human time scale. It's enough so that if you do it for a year or 10 years, you'll get enough of them that you can study them. But it is buried underneath all these ordinary things that are going on all the time. Okay? So you have to work very, very hard to extract new physics underneath all of this stuff. The only reason we have a prayer is a basic fact about what the cross sections look like as a function of energy for the ordinary processes in the standard model. If we get to high enough energies, we should be able to neglect the masses of most of the particles, and just by dimensional analysis, the effective cross section should scale like 1 over energy squared, very roughly speaking, should go down as you go to higher energies. That's another bit of units dimensional analysis that you can do. But the units of cross-section is area. And as a function of energy, the only thing it can be is 1 over energy squared. Okay? So the cross-sections tend to fall as you go to higher energies. On the other hand, if we're producing new massive particles, those new massive particles have a characteristic scale associated with them. And so the events associated with the new particles should be only start showing up above some characteristic mass scale. So we have a hope that even though these rates are huge, we're not actually comparing them. We're not looking for the new particles down here. We're looking at it at higher energies, and we should roughly look for little blips that show up above this steeply falling background. Typically, even this is hard. You have to understand what these backgrounds are very well and subtract them in order to be able to trust any sort of hump that you might see on top of it. Sometimes there are situations where the signals are so spectacular that the backgrounds are almost negligible, and those are, of course, very happy situations that also happen. Okay? So it isn't all necessarily brutal hard work, but certainly lots of brutal hard work is involved. Okay? On top of course, these things needing to be out there. Even if they are out there, the backgrounds have got to be controlled at this kind of precision this gives you an idea of the kind of precision that's actually needed in order to be able to trust that we've seen something new. Okay, so let's talk about some of the things that we could be finding at the LHC in the context of the discussion we were having yesterday. The driving theoretical motivation for believing that we'll see something new at the LHC is the idea that there is going to be a solution to the hierarchy problem involving some kind of dynamics that stabilizes the weak scale, the little hand holding up the pencil from our discussion yesterday. And since we talked about supersymmetry yesterday, let me just focus for a little bit on what supersymmetry would look like. So imagine we take these two protons. We can have a collision between two of the strongly interacting particles, quarks and gluons, inside the proton. And they might have high enough energy to pop the quarks into the quantum dimensions, or in other words, to produce the superpartner of the quarks, the squarks. And the squarks, in turn, they're not stable. A squark on this side, for example, might decay to a quark and the superpartner of the photon, the photino. On the other side, it could do something more complicated. It could decay to a quark and the superpartner of the W particle, the wino, that can go to a positron and a selectron, that can go to an electron and a photino. Okay? So it can be, you can have cascades and chains of decays. All of this stuff is happening in a blink of an eye. 10 to the minus 27 seconds, all this stuff is going on. Okay? So what we see coming out are just these particles in red are the things that are seen coming out. Now, that photino is an interesting object because it's a massive particle which is neutral and barely has any interactions. It only has weak interactions with ordinary matter. So these gigantic detectors, as great and gigantic as they are, these photinos fly right through them. They barely interact with them at all. So they're not detected by the detectors. All that's seen by the detectors is the stuff in red. Okay? And that actually gives an interesting handle to try to discover whether superpartners have been made or not, because if superpartners are made and they decay in this way, one characteristic should be that there's energy and momentum missing from the event. Just like the same way Pauli was motivated to introduce the neutrino from energy and momentum missing in beta decay, so if we see events here with missing energy and momentum, that gives an indication. Doesn't prove that it's supersymmetry, but it's definitely an indication that it's something new, and it's a characteristic associated with this kind of physics. So this is a simulation, alas, not an actual event, but a simulation of what supersymmetry at ATLAS could look like. And so again, so we had two protons coming in transverse to the plane of the slide, and the spray of ordinary particles comes out, but it's even clear by eye in the picture that there's energy and momentum missing. Everything is pointing this way. There's something that should be balancing going the other way, and that's what a missing energy signature could look like. Missing energy, by the way, is one of the good ways of driving down the backgrounds, because most ordinary standard model processes don't produce missing energy. Just with the strong interactions, you don't produce missing energy. If you produce weakly interacting particles and get neutrinos at the end, then that's missing energy. But you can try to control that and understand that enough to try to distinguish it from this kind of missing energy, and so on. So again, it's not a cure-all, but it's something that would definitely help in driving down the backgrounds. And also, an important part of controlling backgrounds is that many of the most important backgrounds aren't really physics backgrounds. They're experimental error backgrounds, okay? You might have some event which is just made out of strongly interacting particles, you know, coming in and out. So just a bunch of jets of strongly interacting particles coming out. But there could be an error in measuring the energy of this big spray of particles. See, the strongly interacting particles don't come out as little individual particles. They come out as jets of particles with lots and lots of, with high multiplicities of particles inside each one of these little inside these jets. So it's easy to just mess up measuring the total energy and momentum in one of those jets. And if you just make a mistake, then it could be that if you add up all the energy and momentum, it doesn't cancel. Just doesn't cancel because of experimental error. Okay? So Again, it's not a cure-all, just saying that there's missing energy. But experimentalists are clever, and they for instance, if they have it, so they have the collection of these jets of strongly interacting particles, and they see that the missing energy and momentum is pointing in that direction, and they see that it's actually pointing in the direction of one of the jets, they say, that's unlikely to be supersymmetry. That's likely to be that I just screwed up measuring the energy of the jet in that direction. Okay? And anyway, so there's lots and lots of checks and ideas like that you have to have in order to be able to pull these kinds of signals out. But that's roughly what it looks like. Now, that's a speculative. Hopefully we're going to see something like that, but there's no guarantee. The thing that the LHC absolutely had to see was the Higgs particle. And this is the way the Higgs is produced at the LHC. The dominant process, you see, remember, the Higgs has couplings to the W particle, the Z particle, and to it couples to the electron, it couples to fermions, but it has a small coupling to electrons. It has a small coupling to up quarks and down quarks that are inside the proton. The big couplings that it has are to the W particle, the Z particle, and top quarks. Unfortunately, there are no... The proton is not made out of top quarks. The proton is not made out of W's and Z's. So there just isn't a very, very big coupling between the initial state of the two protons and the Higgs. Okay? So the way the Higgs is actually produced is through this beautiful quantum mechanical process. Two gluons in the proton produce out of the vacuum a top-anti-top pair. And because the top quark has a big coupling to the Higgs, this gives a good rate for producing the Higgs. Okay? So that's the dominant way that the Higgs is produced at the LHC. Now, this also gives you an idea of why another thing that makes it hard to see new particles, not just the Higgs, although it's there in the case of the Higgs, but just to give you another example of the kind of work that our colleagues, our experimental colleagues, have to do. This process, it's pretty small, but it's big enough that just with the LHC right now, there are, I don't know, 50,000, 100,000 Higgses have probably been produced by the LHC so far, okay? Just from this process. That sounds like a big number. Oh, 50,000, 100,000 Higgses, that's awesome, right? You know, that's lots and lots of Higgses have been produced. But the problem is, the vast majority of the time, a Higgs decays to the heaviest particle it possibly can, because it has bigger and bigger couplings to heavier and heavier particles. And actually, but if the Higgs is lighter than, let's say, twice the mass of the W, it can't go to a pair of W's. If it's lighter than twice the mass of the top, it can't go to two tops, it can't go to two W's. It just goes to the heaviest thing it can. The heaviest thing it can, if its mass is less than roughly twice the mass of the W, is it can go to two bottom quarks. That's what the Higgs does 99.9% of the time, decays to two W's. That's wonderful, because we work very hard to make 100,000 Higgses, and they decay to two bottom quarks. Now, the rate at which these two bottom quarks are made by ordinary strong interaction processes is several orders of magnitude larger than that. So you do all this work, you produce these Higgses, and they just contribute an immeasurable blip on top of the normal rate with which bottom quarks are made. So tough luck. That's not how you see the Higgs. What you have to do is wait for the 0.1% of the time that it decays in another way. Okay, 0.1% of the time, the Higgs will decay basically by a process similar to this, although in this case also W's in the loop contribute significantly, but by similar process, back to photons here. Okay? So 0.1% of the time, they decay to two photons. And that's what you wait to see, because that has a relatively smaller background than just the strong interaction production of bottom quarks, which just completely swamps it. Okay? So that's why we have to wait this long, 100,000, multiplied by 10 to the minus 3, which is the fraction of time this happened, is hundreds. And that's still a reasonable number of events that you can go and look for and play with. But those are the sorts of events, the numbers that we're talking about for the discovery of the Higgs. Now, as of last fall, the search for the Higgs had been narrowed to a very, very small window of masses. Experiments in the by the late 90s and the early 2000s, the previous round of experiments at CERN, with electron-positron collisions, the LEP experiments, had ruled out a Higgs with a mass underneath 115 GeV, and the LHC experiments had ruled out things with a mass above around 140 GeV already by last summer, by the end of last summer. So already last summer, we knew it had to be between 140 and 115 GeV in mass. A number of people, not serious physicists, but I remember a number of people saying, ah, there's no way it's there. How is it possible that it's there? I mean, you've ruled it out everywhere. You're telling me it's going to be the very last place you looked? There's no way it's there. Ha ha, your guys' stupid ether that you invented, that you call the Higgs mechanism, it's not there. You know, it's my crackpot theory instead. I told you so. And this is particularly important for me personally because I had bet several years of salary that the Higgs would be discovered. Okay. I shouldn't have done it, it was a joke, but I got lots of emails from people taking me up on this bet. Now I wasn't nervous at all. None of us were nervous. None of us in the field, hardly any of us in the field were nervous. Because we've known for a long time that the Higgs should be in exactly this mass range. Okay? This is what I mentioned yesterday. That's what really good ideas in our subject look like. There's a big idea, then there's very detailed, precise calculations that go along with that big idea. Here the big idea was this mechanism for giving masses to the W and the Z, which involves some beautiful theoretical physics. But in the early 90s, there were experiments done, also at LEP, that measured very, very precisely the couplings of the Z to other particles. Okay? Basically, millions of Zs were produced in the early 90s, and very precise study of millions of Zs were done. And from those studies already, it became clear that if there was that, first of all, there was indirect evidence that there was a Higgs from just those measurements. They weren't directly being produced, but the virtual effects were being probed. And it was clear that the Higgs mass would prefer to be somewhere in this range, you know, somewhere definitely, certainly beneath 200 GeV, probably somewhere beneath 150 GeV to 100 GeV, that kind of range is where we've known for 20 years it's going to be. We've known, not directly, but because we trust our equations. We trust the general structure. We trust equations. We trust experiments. You know, things don't lie. Unless there is some conspiracy, things don't lie. So we've known for a long time that that's where it's going to be. And it's just too bad that it took experimentalists a long time to get there. It just so happens it's to be in one of the hardest places to find it. But that's it. You know, no one promised us a rose garden. And so we knew it had to be there. So none of us were nervous. And, of course, as you all know, it's quite plausible that it's actually been discovered. Okay? Back on December 13th, we may have found it in a place in a mass at around 125 GeV, perfectly reasonable place to be. We're all very happy. Now, we also have very high standards in this field. So the level of statistical significance of these discoveries at Atlas and CMS do not rise to the level of what we normally call a discovery in the subject, which is, you know, which is a hammer coming out of the plot and hitting you on the head, right? That's a five sigma, okay? It's not like that. It doesn't even rise to the official, super official definition of what's called an observation in particle physics, okay? So it's not been certified, but one way or another, this subject is going to come to a close. Whether we've seen it or not is something that's going to be decided on the month scale now. So by the summer, we're just going to know one way or another. Okay? So either of these things were both flukes, the two experiments saw something with the correct properties and a number of channels in roughly the same spot. Either that will turn out to be a fluke or not. I think it's very unlikely that it's going to be a fluke. Much more likely it's going to be just confirmed, and in 6 or 8 months we can have an actual party. Many of us all around the world who weren't at CERN, especially those of us in North America, got up at an ungodly early hour in the morning in order to watch the seminar where these results were being presented. And we certainly did that at Princeton. And we didn't have champagne, but we had apple cider. I thought that was a good, appropriate level of celebration for, but perhaps we'll have champagne. Hopefully, we look forward to having champagne by the summer. Okay, so what is it that we might know looking forward? What is it that we might know by 2020 from results from the LHC? It could be that we discover something like supersymmetry, or like it, something like it. Something that holds up the pencil, something that gives a mechanism for stabilizing the weak scale. And I think if it is actually supersymmetry, then there would be euphoria. It would be the first extension of our notion of space-time since Einstein, the first example of a broken space-time symmetry. We would see in our faces that there is no fine-tuning for the question of why is gravity weak. We will have another success story tick mark to explaining puzzles like that. It'll be put in the textbooks right along the side of antimatter as an example of a theoretical puzzle that forced this doubling of the universe, and which was dutifully discovered by experimentalists. In the case of antimatter, it was dutifully discovered by experimentalists, you know, a few years after it was proposed. And here it would be dutifully discovered by experiments 40 years after it was first proposed. But, you know, physics is getting harder. You should know that, by the way, okay? Physics is getting harder, so it was easier a long time ago. Then again, they didn't have computers and gigantic accelerators, so maybe the ratio of difficulty to tools is constant. Hopefully for you. But anyway, that's what it would be like. Now, it would leave open still the question of why the cosmological constant is small. Okay, because supersymmetry, while it greatly ameliorates the cosmological constant problem, as we discussed yesterday, it certainly does not solve it. Okay? So it takes it from a problem of 120 orders of magnitude to 60 orders of magnitude. So the discovery of supersymmetry at the LHC would tell us nothing about what solves the cosmological constant problem. That's fine. We don't solve every problem in physics simultaneously, but that's just what it would be like. Now, what if we continue to only see the Higgs and nothing else? That's very, very confusing. It's very confusing because just on the face of it, and when I say that, I mean, you know, we have to really convince ourselves we're not missing things, look in every corner, but, you know, we've given it 10 years. We're talking about 2020. Just looks like the Higgs and nothing else. Then I think we start having, for the first time, some fairly dramatic evidence that there's fine-tuning in a sector of the theory that we can really control and observe and study in particle physics, okay? That would be very, very surprising. It's not something that we've run into. Actually, it is something that we've seen circumstantially in other parts of the field. If I had two more lectures, I would spend some time talking about it. But it's certainly not something that what we would have ever encountered quite so dramatically as we would here. Really, it would be the first indication of some kind of fine adjustment of the parameters. Now, you could say, isn't the cosmological constant already an indication of some fine adjustment of the parameters? We have no mechanism to explain what it is. That's true, but you could always say, oh, it's about cosmology, and it's, you know, it's so confusing, we don't know what it is, it's some gravity, it's deep. You say the word deep and gravity and mystery many times in many different orders, and you just convince yourself that it's okay not to think about the problem. But it would be very strange if it happened in a sector of the theory that's much closer to our homes, okay, that we control, we do experiments on, and if we saw this fine-tuning there, I think to many of us, it would start looking quite analogous to the cosmological constant. And it would be some indication that perhaps there's a common mechanism that addresses both of them. There are other intermediate possibilities that I won't have time to talk about. There are other scenarios that we might see that would give us more than the Higgs and might give us more of a push in one of these directions or another. So there's lots of intermediate scenarios that we could talk about as well. But this is very broadly the kind of issues that are at stake. See, really what I want to point out is that I think we're, in this part of the field, at a real moment of bifurcation between two possible pictures for what the universe looks like, one of which continues very much along a trajectory that we've been on for four centuries, and another one of which really starts making a right turn compared to things that we've encountered before. You know, poetically, it's this choice between order and chaos. We might either see this little hand holding up the pencil, extension of short distance space-time symmetries. Everything is going absolutely awesomely the way it's been going for 100 years. There's unification of couplings. We have these new quantum dimensions. Or we might start certainly not getting direct evidence for this, certainly not direct experimental evidence, but circumstantial evidence, more and more of a push towards taking seriously this orthogonal picture. Where there's on enormous scales, it's not a modification of space-time at short scales, but a modification of the usual picture of space-time on enormous scales. There's this huge, very inhomogeneous universe, most of which is lethal, much of which is empty, and a few teeny tiny corners, accidentally, the parameters of the long-distance world are such that structure can arise. And in those places are the places where observers are going to find themselves to make observations about the world. And in that case, the fine-tuning of the cosmological constant and even these fine-tunings for the Higgs might find a common sort of explanation. I think these are certainly the two extremes for what we might learn from the LHC. And again, this one is something we can sharply learn, for sure. This is never something we can sharply confirm. Okay? Until we figure out how to make sense of this picture or see the other universes, not the other universes, the other places in this multiverse, whatever that means. It's not something we can sharply confirm, but it's something we can get a big push towards, I think, depending on the outcome of this experiment. Okay, so that's all for all I want to say about the LHC. And I now want to spend a few minutes setting up what I'm going to talk about tomorrow, which is this other sense, this less commonly appreciated sense, of being in an era with lots of data. This is the sense in which we have lots of theoretical data to explore and try to understand something new about the way the world works, not in far-off reaches of accelerators or far-off reaches of space, but just by studying amazing mathematical structures that we're seeing in quantum field theory. And I want to remind you of the first set of challenges that we talked about on the second day, which in some ways are the, I think, the really big, big, big challenges of this century. Okay? The really big challenge is to understand what space-time and quantum mechanics really are. And for the reasons that we discussed, there's very good reasons to be suspicious of one of them, and some reasons to suspect that at least our notion of what quantum mechanical observables are needs to be extended or modified somehow in cosmological context. So these are very big problems. There are also problems that it's not obvious that we're ever going to get direct hints from experiment about what's going on. It's not obvious that we're going to be able to do experiments near the Planck scale to directly probe what's going on with quantum mechanics and gravity at the Planck scale, for example. Now, so that might, and has for a long time, discouraged some group of people from working on these questions. You say, oh, you can think and work hard all you want, but we're never going to get any direct hints from experiment for what's going on up there. There's always been an orthogonal attitude, and there was an orthogonal attitude certainly in the 1980s, that finding a consistent theory that makes sense is so difficult and is and is going to be so rigidly constrained that it might be that the answer is unique. And if the answer is unique, then even though we can't go up there, it'll make so many other predictions at lower energies that we can be convinced that it's right. Okay? That was another attitude. As I said, it seems very, very implausible now that that attitude is correct. It's very plausible that there is a unique underlying theory, but it's very implausible that it has a unique long-distance instantiation. Okay? And so so that motivation seems, if the idea is that we don't need hints from experiment because we'll just find the theory and determine all the parameters, that doesn't seem to be that doesn't seem to be the way things are going to go. So we're left again with asking the question. So did we have any hope thinking about these problems? Well, you know, there's always hope. There's always great hope. And it's always important to be ambitious and to attack problems, but in a way which has some constraint on what you're doing, so you have a sense that you're making progress. The string theorists who began this program in the 1980s, many of them hoping the answer was going to end up being unique, were led by the theory to find that the first sense in which they thought the problem might be addressed, that they defined a unique solution, doesn't seem to be plausible. But along the way, they discovered these other incredible things. They discovered this equivalence between field theory and gravity. This astonishing thing that no one expected was an outcome of this effort. Good deeds in physics, and certainly in theoretical physics, never go unrewarded. It doesn't matter what motivation you come up with. If you're doing something non-trivial, it will eventually find a purpose in life. And in this case, against the desire of most of the practitioners in the subject, they were led, on the one hand, to this picture of a gigantic landscape, but along the way, on the other hand, to this astonishing discovery of the complete equivalence between quantum field theory and quantum gravity. Okay? So this is a good, it's a good model for how progress can happen. I mean, you have to take a rigid and deep structure and study it, and things will come out of it. But what we've now learned is that quantum gravity is quantum field theory. So trying to understand what quantum gravity is the same as trying to really understand what quantum field theory is. And that gives us more of a chance for making progress, because we know lots about quantum field theories already, and we can look to see whether there are clues in them that pushes us towards the resolution to some of these problems. There's a big precedent for this kind of thing earlier in the history of physics, a number of times. There have been a number of junctures in the history of physics. Some of the very biggest ideas were not actually associated with pushing the experimental frontier of the time. Okay? Experiments have always been very important, but they have not always been critical in driving the important conceptual developments. Sometimes the most crucial clues are the ones that are hiding in plain sight under our noses as funny features of the existing theoretical framework. This has happened over and over again. It happened to Einstein. I mean, Einstein was the master of this subject of finding things hiding in plain sight. Okay? There were features of Newtonian physics, features that people had noticed, but they either shrugged or they didn't think there was anything funny about it. Okay? But let's talk about some of them. Einstein didn't invent the idea of relativity. Galileo invented the idea of relativity. Okay? Classical physics has Galilean invariants. The Galilean group is just as big as the Lorentz group. Okay? They're exactly the central observation that there's relativity is an ancient one. Okay? However, there was a strange feature of Newtonian physics. It's not local. The interactions aren't local. There was action at a distance. Okay? This bothered Newton's contemporaries, and Newton told them to buzz off because his theory agreed with nature. It also bothered Newton. Okay? But Newtonian physics was not local. Now, if you have Galilean invariance is what's directly associated with the non-locality of Newtonian physics, because You can, if you go faster and faster, send a signal arbitrarily quickly from one place in the universe to another place in the universe. So somehow the only way to remove this funny feature of non-locality while preserving the idea of relativity is to deform Galilean invariance to Lorentz invariance. Okay? But there it was. The relativity was sitting there, and the funny features were sitting there to be understood. And that, so Galilean invariance was a big clue sitting there already for the existing of the underlying Lorentz invariance, together with the strange non-locality of Newtonian physics. Of course, the other thing that he famously did was realize that the funny feature in Newtonian physics of the equality between gravitational and inertial masses should be turned on its head and forced to be explained automatically by the correct theory of gravity. And that led him to the realization that gravity is the effect of space-time curvature. Both of these were not clues that came from the latest, greatest experiment of the day, okay, but they were just features of the existing physics, of the existing theoretical structure, that were not inconsistent, there's nothing wrong with them, but they were funny, and they needed explanation. They needed a deeper explanation. The deeper explanation led to a whole host of other theoretical breakthroughs, of course. Ultimately, these theoretical breakthroughs led to predictions that agreed with experiments, so that's the really important thing. But the experiments were not needed to drive these observations to begin with. Something very similar is actually sitting there as we go from classical to quantum mechanics. This is not quite how the history worked in this case. Here we have Einstein, and this is how the history worked for Einstein. Okay? Now I'm telling you something where the history didn't quite work this way, but it could have. And actually, if I had longer to talk about history, I would tell you how Hamilton might have discovered quantum mechanics if he'd been given long enough. But there's a funny feature of classical mechanics, a strange feature of classical mechanics that quantum mechanics explains. Okay? It's just a strange feature of classical mechanics, but quantum mechanics explains why it's that way. And that is the fact that classical mechanics, even though it was discovered and invented by Newton as this beautiful, deterministic, clockwork picture of the universe theory, okay, as deterministic as you can possibly get, nature is described by second-order differential equations. You give initial positions and velocities and predict everything in the future. That people later discovered other formulations of classical physics that don't look manifestly deterministic. Okay? In fact, people discovered the principle of least action as another way of formulating classical mechanics. Okay, and this is not new physics. Okay? It's just another way of talking about classical mechanics. But this way of talking about classical mechanics looks really weird if you believe in this clockwork picture of the deterministic universe. When you first learn the principle of least action, it looks like an extremely undeterministic thing. Like a particle looks every way it could take from A to B, and then it decides to take the one that minimizes the action. Okay? Of course, it's completely equivalent. Because of the kinds of paths you allow, the kinds of variations you allow, the way you set up the problem, this just gives you Newton's laws. Okay? It's just a way of rewriting Newton's laws. But this was already something that bugged many people. Why is there this other way of talking about classical physics that seems so undeterministic? Okay? Now, it's just a funny feature, just a strange funny feature. By the way, this funny feature of classical physics also allowed people to do calculations, concrete calculations that they cared about for celestial mechanics and things like that, that were very hard to do with Newton's laws. Okay? So first of all, it's funny that there's this other formulation of the theory. Also, the other formulation is more practical and useful for actually doing calculations. Okay? This other formulation also makes things obvious that are not so obvious with Newton's laws. It makes conservation laws obvious. The fact that symmetries and conservation laws are related to each other is something that's obvious from this picture and not from the picture of Newton's laws. When you play with Newton's laws, every time you add a new interaction, a new particle, a new anything, you have to keep hunting around for what is the quantity that's conserved. And it's a surprise every time, if I add this to the energy and now this whole thing keeps being conserved. That's the new energy now. Then you add something else, like, oh, crap, you got to go, oh, now I add the electric field squared plus the kinetic and the, oh, now that's conserved now, right? So that's what you have to do with Newton's laws, but from the point of view of the principle of least action, it's just completely obvious that there are symmetries, and the symmetries and conservation laws are related. So if all you know about the world is classical physics, this is a funny feature. But this funny feature was a very powerful clue that there is such a thing as quantum mechanics. Because it's quantum mechanics that explains why the principle of least action exists. The real theory isn't deterministic. The real theory is quantum mechanical, but the h-bar goes to zero limit of quantum mechanics isn't Newton's laws. It's a principle of least action. So this is the sort of thing that could happen to us. It could be that sitting in the structure of theories we know and love already, as it has been in the past, is some clue, or a whole bunch of clues, for another, first of all, another formulation of the physics, but then perhaps beyond that, you know, another theory, a different theory, which addresses some of the problems and mysteries that we were talking about. This is a path forward, mining the structure of quantum field theories for surprises, mining them for things that they do which seem totally mysterious from the usual formulation of the theory, and trying to find some other way of thinking about the theory which makes these crazy things obvious. This is a way forward which is not speculative. It's a way forward where there's a check on your progress at all times. It's a way forward where you know if you're making a mistake or not. You're not trying to wildly guess what the new theory is or what the new physics is. Instead, you're trying to take the physics you have right now and find completely different ways of thinking about it in a way that's guided by the problems that we're trying to solve. In this case, the problems that we're trying to solve are that we think there's something wrong with the notion of space-time. If there's something wrong with the notion of space-time, if space-time doesn't exist fundamentally, there should be some way of talking about all of physics in a way that doesn't make such heavy use of that idea. So there should be some way of reformulating physics in such a way where the notion of the inside of a space-time isn't playing a central role. And we should try to see if it's possible to reformulate quantum field theory in such a way that it doesn't make such heavy use of these ideas that we suspect are going to go away. Now, the wonderful thing is that there are lots of clues, lots and lots of clues from many, many directions that there should be another way of thinking about what quantum field theory is. Okay? There are clues from the fact that people discovered remarkable properties of field theories at strong coupling. When the interactions became strong, normally you just throw up your hands and say you don't know what happens. But people discovered that, no, instead there are other dual descriptions of the physics. Sometimes you have a gauge theory, the interactions become strong, and it's dual, equivalently described by a completely different gauge theory, with a different gauge group, different matter content, everything different, and yet the physics is identical. The most amazing thing that was discovered, all along the same lines, is sometimes when the interactions are strong, this theory of quarks and gluons and a gauge theory is equivalent to a theory of gravity in one higher dimension. Okay? That's an extraordinary thing that quantum field theories do. None of these things are obvious when you just write down an action for Yang-Mills theory. Okay? All of these are just amazing things that come out that are totally unobvious from the way we formulate the physics. So one set of motivations is just to find a formulation of theory that makes these things more obvious. These things shouldn't constantly be miracles. There should be some way of thinking about the physics where these incredible facts become more manifest. So that's been a motivation for a long time to find another formulation. But because of limitations of time, I want to tell you about another set of motivations for the same thing. These are a little bit closer to home. Okay. In fact, these begin, remember, you have to look for funny observations, funny things, strange features of the current theory. And I want to begin by going back to something very practical and bread and butter that we needed to talk about a little while ago. A little while ago when we were talking about backgrounds at the LHC, we talked about these huge rates. We needed to be able to calculate the backgrounds to very, very high accuracy, okay, in order to be able to extract new physics. And so some people then had made it their business in life to calculate these backgrounds to very high accuracy. Okay? It just needed to be done for practical reasons. So we've descended from these lofty heights of modifying space-time and blah, quantum field theory. Just, someone needs to calculate these backgrounds. Okay? For example, supersymmetry, one of the dominant backgrounds to superpartner production, Gluino production, what comes out if you pair produce two Gluinos is each one will decay to two gluons and some missing energy. So what you see coming out are four gluons. So two gluons come in, four gluons go out. They, of course, turn into jets. But you then need to understand the process. Two gluons in, four gluons out. You need to understand that accurately enough to be able to subtract it and see what's sitting underneath it. Okay? Great. So this is a nice calculation that you just have to do. And we know how to do it. Standard formalism of quantum field theory and perturbation theory. Feynman diagrams, we know how to do these calculations. You would not think that this is a place where some deep new secrets about the universe are concealed. In a second, I'm going to tell you this is a place where I think, and many people think, deep new secrets of the universe are concealed. Okay? But let's see why. You're just a practical guy. You just need to do these calculations. Well, this is what happens to you when you start trying to do these calculations. Even if you do it in the lowest order of approximation, so tree-like diagrams, you draw all the tree diagrams, and the first thing that happens is you find there's lots of them for this process. There's 220 Feynman diagrams. Okay? And like 100,000 terms if you expand them all out. So this is a snapshot of what it looks like. That's the 2-to-3 process, not the 2-to-4 process, okay? So the 2-to-3 process, if you just open up, you guys are going to learn all of this in your courses, or maybe you're doing it right now. You open up Peskin and Schroeder's book, you copy down the Feynman rules, you take each one of the diagrams, you plug it in, tuck, tuck, tuck. This is what you get, even just for the 2-to-3 process, okay? And like 24 more pages where this comes from, okay? Okay. Now you say, good, I'm glad I'm not the person who has to do this calculation, right? That's what you would say if you're an idiot like me, okay? But, someone had to do it. These damn experimentalists, they just need the answer. They're going to complain if you don't tell them what the prediction is. So someone has got to go do the calculation. Oh, that poor someone. This 25 pages is too much, okay? In the case, that's maybe manageable for 2-to-3, but 2-to-4 is like, I don't know, 80 pages, okay? This is really, really too much. Now, you might think it looks complicated because it is complicated. You know what else is complicated? You know, take two cars and smash them into each other and ask for the probability the steering wheel comes out at 49 degrees. That's also complicated. And it's just complicated because it's complicated. Okay? You might think this is complicated because it's complicated. There's two gluons coming in, six gluons coming out. This one can hit that one that hits that one. It happens in a zillion ways. You have to add them all up because it's quantum mechanics, so it's complicated. Tough. If that was the answer, I wouldn't be up here talking about it. Okay? Because what actually happened in the late 80s is that because they just needed to do this for practical reasons, as I said, people found really clever tricks to simplify the answer. And what they eventually found is that these 80 pages collapse to a single term. Okay? Now, they collapse, so these gluons are massless particles, at least in this, we're ignoring the fact that they get confined and so on, so we're just talking about the scattering of the massless gluons. And I'll tell you what these symbols mean tomorrow, so don't worry about it. But the amplitude depends on then the momenta of the gluons and their helicities, okay? So they can have helicity plus or minus one. And first what they found is that when all the helicities are plus, the amplitude vanishes. When all but one is plus, the amplitude vanishes. That's already very surprising. These 80 pages simplify really a lot to zero. Okay? And then when two of them are minus and the rest of them are plus, this was the answer. It was a single line, single term. Now, this was a spectacular result at the time. At the time, not everyone thought that this was the harbinger of some radical new way of thinking about quantum field theory. Not everyone thought that this was the tip of a gigantic iceberg. We now know this is the tip of a gigantic iceberg. But at the time, not everyone appreciated that. Part of the reason was it didn't seem that this kind of simplicity persisted to other kinds of amplitudes. Okay? So it's also very important to be skeptical, you know, always keep a cool head, look for evidence, because accidents also happen, right? Not everything is a hint of something dramatic. And in fact, when people tried to do the next most complicated calculations with 3 plus and 3 minus, that was, again, many, many pages, very, very complicated. And when they tried to do loop calculations, hopelessly complicated. Okay? So this kind of simplicity didn't seem to persist. Okay? But we now know that it was the tip of a gigantic iceberg. Okay? And that's what I'll spend more of the day telling you about tomorrow. But what I want you to take away from this for now is that there's clearly something wrong with the usual way of talking about quantum field theory. Not even at strong coupling, not in these mysterious places, right in the home base of the subject, right in the place where it came from, in perturbation theory, understanding scattering processes, the standard way of doing things has a job to do. The standard way of doing things makes locality manifest, it makes unitarity manifest, it makes the principles of quantum mechanics and relativity manifest. That's fantastic because those principles are true. But it's hiding something. It can't be the final word on the subject, or it can't be the only word on the subject, because this is the answer, even though when we try to make locality and unitarity manifest, we think that the answer should be 80 pages. Okay? Sorry?
80 pages also reproduce the same answer?
Of course it does, yes. Now, in fact, by now, let me tell you what, I'll just tell you a little bit more just to whet your appetite for it tomorrow. We now know what all these tree amplitudes are, how to write them all down in a very compact way. Okay? But in particular, let's go back to the 6 particle amplitude and look at the generic situation where 3 are plus and 3 are minus. Okay? So we did all the other ones. This is the one last remaining one. And as I said, this is a this business is all about theoretical data. That means that that people have been calculating these amplitudes for 60 years, and if there is some remarkable new way of thinking about what they are, there's a check on your ideas. You first have to agree with everything that's been calculated for the last 60 years, reproduce all those things. Then you have to produce new things that haven't been computed before. But you can check whether those things are right or not, because if you're not using Feynman diagrams, if you're not using things that make the usual rules of locality and unitarity manifest, then you can check if your answer satisfies locality, and you can check if it satisfies unitarity. And if it does, then you're confident that it's right. Okay? So as with any data-rich subject, big advances happen when new technologies are developed that allow you to gather more data. Okay? In this case, the new technologies that were developed back in 2005 were a remarkable and powerful set of theoretical tools of recursion relations that allowed people to calculate these scattering amplitudes at tree level very, very effectively. This goes under the name of BCFW recursion relations after Brito, Cachazzo, Fang, and Witten. And again, you don't need to know what these symbols mean for now, but this is what the answer looks like in general. Okay. It's actually just one term plus 2 images. See, this has a plus, minus, plus. So it has a natural cyclic symmetry shifting everything over by 2. So there's one object plus its 2 images. Those 80 pages collapse to these 3 terms. So it continues to be amazingly simple, shockingly simple. But now something new and very important was revealed in this way of writing things. Each term is, everything is incredibly simple. However, this term all by itself turns out not to have any kind of interpretation in terms of a local process in space-time. I'll explain this in a little more detail tomorrow, but if you just stare at an expression like this, the kinds of poles that it has, the kinds of singularities that it has, tells you whether it corresponds to something local or non-local in space-time. And this one is definitely not local in space-time. Some of these poles that occur in the denominator here do correspond to local things, and these funny things do not. So something wonderful is happening. The answer is incredibly simple, because the building blocks don't care about locality. So that's another indication. These things are coming from somewhere, which doesn't care that much about ordinary space-time. More things happened in the intervening couple of years now. Around 4 years ago, people discovered that these amplitudes, which at tree level are just amplitudes for gluons, okay, just good old-fashioned gluons, Yang-Mills theory. These are things that Yang and Mills could have discovered in 1955 if someone told them exactly where to look. No, they didn't need anything other than the tools available to them in 1955. Of course, they'd have to work very, very hard, and someone would have to tell them exactly where to look, but they were just there, okay? Just at the tree level of approximation. If we will go beyond tree level and talk about the whole theory, including all quantum corrections, then what's been well studied are very supersymmetric theories, very special theories, and so that's where most of the activity has been. But there's many reasons to expect that these kind of structures persist even beyond these very supersymmetric theories. And at any rate, they're certainly there equally well in the non-supersymmetric and supersymmetric theories if we deal with tree-level structures. Okay? And in fact, what was discovered around 4 years ago is that there is a hidden symmetry that these amplitudes have. In fact, there's a hidden infinite-dimensional symmetry that the amplitudes have. Because these particles are massless, any theory of massless particles enjoys a conformal symmetry. Conformal symmetry is, first of all, there's just Lorentz invariance, translations and Lorentz invariance. There's an obvious part of conformal. If everything is massless, if you rescale all energies and momenta by a common amount, nothing should change because the energies and momenta are the only things that set any scale. So there is the Poincaré symmetry, there is rescaling, dilations. And there's the non-trivial part of the conformal symmetry is something more exciting. It's the symmetry under inversions. So this is a symmetry that takes a point in space-time and replaces it by x mu over x squared. Okay? This is kind of amazing that theories have this symmetry at all. If you haven't encountered inversions, you actually secretly have encountered them if you've ever solved that problem in electromagnetism where you have a grounded sphere. And you put a charge on the outside of a grounded sphere, and you want to find the electric field everywhere, right? When people solve that problem in books, you use the method of images. And you find there's this very clever place where you can put another charge. Where is it? It's exactly at this location, x over x squared. Okay, and you cleverly choose its charge, you cleverly choose its position, and magically you find, the surface of the sphere is in equipotential. Okay, and that's how you solve it using the method of images. Something that you should know is that there's never tricks. Physics is never about cleverness and is never about tricks. Sometimes you can be clever, and clever people are at an advantage, okay? At some advantage. But in the end, there's nothing, little clicks and being, you know, ingenious and stuff like that is not what it's about. And if there is something that looks like it's a consequence of something ingenious, there's probably something deeper underneath it, which is a principle which is making it work. In this case, this ingenious location of the image charge and the ingenious charge that you have to put on it to make it work is a reflection of a deep fact that the theory has conformal symmetry. It has a symmetry under inversions. Okay? I mentioned this, that if you ever find these things that seem like they're odd things that you have to be very, very smart to figure out, it's probably telling you something. You should find some way of thinking about it which is deep, not clever. And the more often you look for a deep, not clever explanation, the better shape that you'll be in. Okay. Anyway, so this is the non-trivial symmetry, inversions. And that's the real heart of the non-trivial part of conformal symmetry. Okay, anyway, but that's the symmetries that theories of massless particles enjoy. Relativistic theories of massless particles have conformal invariants. So theory of gluons, the scattering of gluons at tree level, has conformal invariants. But the thing that people discovered, which is remarkable, is that it has another conformal invariance in a completely different space. So to see that, imagine taking the momenta of the particles, p1, p2, p3, p4, p5, the momenta of all the gluons, and just draw them end by end by end by end on a piece of paper. Just draw the vector. Here's the p1, here's p2, p3, but just draw them one after the other, after the other, on a four-dimensional piece of paper, okay? Here I'm imagining that all the momenta of the particles are outgoing, so that momentum conservation is a statement that the sum of all these momenta adds up to zero, and so that means that these vectors close into a polygon, okay? They close into a nice closed polygon. I can make that manifest by saying that each momentum is a difference between these two coordinates, okay? So if I put the corners of the polygon to be x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, I'm saying that each PA is xA plus 1 minus xA. So I've introduced some funny new coordinates, x, these x coordinates, and the units of these coordinates are momenta. Okay, so it's not normal space-time, it's some other funny space-time where the units of the coordinates are momenta, and differences between coordinates are the momentum of the gluons that we care about. Okay? What people discovered experimentally, what I mean experimentally is they did calculations, and by staring at the result, they saw that it had a surprising feature. The surprising feature that they discovered is that the amplitudes were invariant under conformal transformations in this space. Not the original space-time, but this dual space-time. In fact, what people quickly thereafter realized is that what some person in our space-time would call the scattering of gluons coming in, they bang into each other and they go out, you get some complicated function of the momenta of the gluons coming in and going out, perhaps, that the same function could be interpreted by someone in this space-time, totally different space-time, as the answer to a totally different question. Imagine you have this funny polygon whose edges are null in this dual space, and just calculate the Aronoff-Bohm phase that a gluon would experience if you dragged it around this polygon. Okay? That Aronoff-Bohm phase is also a function of the shape of this polygon, the momenta, and so on. That function and the scattering amplitudes are the same. Totally different interpretation, exactly the same function. Then after that, it was discovered that actually what made the symmetry obvious were these recursion relations I told you about a moment ago. Okay. Term by term, when you calculate the scattering amplitudes using these recursion relations, for example, those three terms that I showed you, each one of those terms was individually invariant under all the symmetries of the theory, both of them. Okay. So when I write this expression down, this now also beautifully explains why it had to have these things that didn't look local. They don't look local because these expressions, these objects, don't care about space-time. They don't care about the other space-time. Their point in life is to make all the symmetries that the theory has manifest. So that's another indication that there is, first of all, two completely different space-times on which this theory wants to live, with two totally different interpretations for the same underlying object. And furthermore, that there is some formulation that doesn't care about either space-time, it just gives you the answer in terms of these elementary building blocks. These two symmetries, I'm just telling you some words now, this conformal symmetry and this dual conformal symmetry, they don't commute with each other, and together they actually generate an infinite dimensional symmetry algebra. It's the biggest symmetry algebra I think we've encountered in our part of physics. It's a huge symmetry algebra, and it's known as the Yangian. A name, but it's remarkable that this Yangian symmetry has shown up in other parts of physics. It shows up in condensed matter physics all the time. It shows up in the study of spin chains. If you've solved the Heisenberg spin chain problem in your statistical mechanics courses, it's a problem that you can solve where the Hamiltonian is the sum of the nearest neighbor interactions between spins. It's a problem that you can solve because it turns out that this problem has infinitely many conserved quantum numbers that are not obvious. But there's a whole infinite class of them. This is the first one of things that commute with the Hamiltonian. And for the Heisenberg spin chain, it enjoys this infinite dimensional Yangian symmetry. It's called the Yangian of SU2. The Yangian symmetry enjoyed by scattering amplitudes is a very similar one. But what on earth do the scattering of gluons in four dimensions have to do with spins on a spin chain? It's another indication that there is some completely different way of thinking about what this problem is, which is not going to make any explicit reference to a four-dimensional space-time. If anything, there's going to be some kind of spin chain underlying it, perhaps. Okay. Yes? All of them. Order by order, all of them. So these are some details that we can talk about tomorrow. All right, so let me just make a comment, because it's too wonderful not to mention. These developments that I mentioned, these two big developments, are both associated with people who are students here at the ICTP in the not-distant past. Probably the person who more than anyone aided and developed the technology that made it possible to see all these structures in tree-level amplitudes and one-loop amplitudes and so on was Freddy Cacciazzo, who's now at the Perimeter Institute. And the person who was deeply involved with discovering this dual conformal symmetry and this interpretation of it in terms of the Aronoff-Bohm phase dragged around this polygon in the dual space was Fernando Aldai. These are probably the two most important developments in this subject in the last decade. And they're both associated with people who were sitting up here in the seats where many of you are now. Yes? Okay. Well, no, I know he spent I meant this phrase broadly. He was definitely sitting in the audience with many of these people at talks, perhaps not talks like this, but other talks. All right. Sorry. All right. Freddie was. Yes. Freddie was. I knew that, but I didn't want to split hairs here. Okay. All right. But anyway, they are the two superstars, two of the superstars of the subject, and they were sitting up there with where many of you are sitting now for a number of years. All right. So let me end then by asking, so I've shown you something now. Here is a funny feature of standard physics. Okay, you actually start calculating anything beyond 2-to-2 scattering. Feynman calculated 2-to-2 amplitudes, and that was awesome. He did it in half a day, and it took other people 6 months. So it was a huge theoretical, conceptual, computational advance to learn how to make Lorentz invariance and unitarity play together in a more manifest way, which is what Feynman diagrams do by giving this space-time interpretation for what perturbation theory is, okay? But you try to do the next most complicated thing, and it's already 2-to-3, it's already 30 pages, 2-to-4 is 80 pages. So then you either think it is complicated or you keep pushing and you find, no, it's actually not complicated. And there's this whole marvelous structure with this other space-time and these symmetries that you don't see. So this is a funny feature of standard quantum field theory that seems to beg for a deeper explanation. Perhaps an explanation, okay, but before we get to what it might be suggesting, is we should just ask, why are Feynman diagrams so complicated? And the reason isn't some irrelevant technicality. The reason is precisely because they make unitarity and locality manifest at the same time. We'll discuss this at more length tomorrow, but the entire point of this formalism is to make unitarity and locality manifest at the same time. But what that entails is the introduction of a large amount of redundancy in our description of the physics as soon as we talk about particles that have spin 1 or higher. Okay? There are things that in older books are often worshipped as fantastic, wonderful things. Gauge symmetry, diffeomorphism invariance. These are deep, fantastic, wonderful things. They are deep things, but they're not invariant properties of the physics. They are things which we, as human beings, introduce to be able to study the interactions of these massless particles in a way that makes the principles of quantum mechanics and relativity manifest. There are tools. There are language, but they're not actually a property of the physics itself. And it's exactly the introduction of this huge amount of gauge redundancy, diffeomorphisms for gravity. We won't talk about gravity too much, but even worse for gravity. It's exactly that makes the answer so complicated. Okay? We have to drag around all of this extra unphysical stuff in the computations for the sole purpose of being guaranteed that it's local and unitary. Okay? So it dovetails very nicely then with the motivations that maybe there's something wrong with space-time for these deep reasons on the one hand. Then we drew calculations. The calculations are horrendously complicated. Why? Because we're trying to make locality so manifest by introducing all this gauge redundancy on the other hand. So perhaps there's some way of thinking about quantum field theory in a way that doesn't make such heavy use of locality and unitarity, but amongst other things, what it could do is make manifest all of this wonderful structure. And some of that is starting to emerge. And I'll tell you a little bit about it tomorrow. As I said, this is one aspect of a very big, it's one aspect of this desire to find some way of reformulating field theory. There are other parts of the problem that have nothing to do with scattering amplitudes. You know, there are mathematical aspects of the problem. There are other physical aspects of the problem about the behavior of quantum field theories at strong coupling. There are lots and lots of indications that something like this is needed. This is one of them. Okay, it's one of them. It's one that that a number of people have been working on. I've been working on. It's perhaps one of the most recent ones which has come on the scene, and it has the nice feature of involving observables that are very close to things that we care about, you know, good old-fashioned gluons, scattering amplitudes. Some of the ideas have even been important for calculating backgrounds at the LHC. Okay, these BCFW recursion relations that compute tree-level scattering amplitudes are actually used by a large number of the programs that practically calculate backgrounds for the LHC. So it's not just all theoretical mumbo-jumbo. It's actually really even been practically useful. But it's not the practically useful aspect that I'm going to talk about tomorrow. But the great thing about all of this is that it has been sitting under our noses for 60 years. All of this structure has been sitting there. It could have been seen and noticed at any time in the last 60 years. And it's remarkable that it's been seen and noticed and observed and studied in the last 10 years, 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, more and more and more. And I think by now it's clear that there is really something here, okay? That there's something here. This something combines ideas from string theory, ideas from condensed matter, studying spin chains, ideas from twisters. This was a this was an ugly duckling of theoretical physics for many years, but many ideas from twister theory have a role to play. And as well, and surprisingly to many of us, a host of new mathematical structures in algebraic geometry. Parts of mathematics that have never had anything to do with physics before seem to be heavily involved in this business. And I think they're all converging to some new picture for what scattering is, at least scattering, if not all of quantum field theory in any number of dimensions, at least scattering for gluons in four dimensions, which doesn't put in space-time. But makes a lot of these other remarkable structures manifest. And that's what we'll take up next time and talk about tomorrow.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Nima, again. I'm sure there are some questions.
Lambda. The cosmological constant is a dimensionful parameter, like Newtonian constant.
Yes.
We also have h-bar, which is dimensionful.
H-bar is not a dimensionful parameter.
Okay, you said 2-1.
Yes.
Okay. Why do we worry so much? Why don't we consider lambda another fundamental constant, like g Newton?
Well, I mean.
In other words, if we didn't have quantum mechanics, would we worry about this problem?
I don't think so, no.
So it's the fact that we have quantum mechanics.
Yeah, I mean, it's in a world that's not quantum mechanical, nothing stops you from a way of saying that you could set it and forget it. You could just say there are just two hugely different scales, and that's just the way it is, and that's it. Okay, there's just one big number that you put in. But that's what you'd have to do. You just have to say there's one very large number, you know, 10 to the 120. One very, very large number, and that number is there. The number that you have to choose is either very, very big or very, very small. You might then imagine that there's some theory you might come up with, which in some approximation it's infinity and then, or zero, and then it's some perturbation to that makes it very big or very small. The difficulty we have because of the quantum fluctuations is that the number isn't 10 to the minus 120. The number is some random number like 2.976437 ... that we just have to finally adjust to have a specific value to 120 decimal places, okay? It's not very big or very small. It has to be finely adjusted to 120 decimal places against something else. It's, or said more physically, the quantum fluctuations want to completely destroy, I mean, classically there's no sort of pressure that would want to make these scales the same. They're just two independent things, and you can make it whatever you want. Quantum mechanically, there are fluctuations that want to make them the same. The huge quantum fluctuations want to make them the same. The real mystery is why there's any kind of macroscopic world at all. When there's gigantic quantum fluctuations, which are bigger and bigger, as a power law, bigger and bigger as you get to smaller and smaller distances. That is the mystery.
So in a sense, sorry, I just want to ask you. In a sense, for instance, you could assume that lambda is whatever it is and try to explain why M Planck is.
Sure, you could do anything so you want. The real mystery is the dimensionless ratio, lambda over M Planck to the fourth. The only quantities that we ever talk about are dimensionless. Okay, so it's lambda over M Planck to the fourth is the real mystery.
Thank you.
More questions?
You told that actually behind straightforward calculations of trillions of, okay, not trillions, but some big number of Feynman diagrams, the answer is structurally much simpler than one could expect, and that there is some explanation of that in terms of double conformal invariance, in
Right. Well, it's related to the fact that there's a dual conformal symmetry.
In two spaces. The question is, there is a remarkable property of quantum electrodynamics is that it is renormalizable. So what means renormalizability? Is there any further understanding of what renormalizability means from this new description?
Well, I mean, let me take your question in two parts. The more modern understanding, or modern means from the 60s and 70s of the Wilsonian way of thinking about quantum field theory and effective field theory in particular, we know there's no big deal about renormalizability or not. There's the theory, whatever it is, at high energies, and it has some, there's some high energy physics at high energies, and whatever that theory is, at long distances, it's guaranteed to be described by a theory that looks renormalizable together with some suppressed interactions that tell you about the physics that it's hard to access at much, much higher energy scales. So that's that is a basic fact. And at the moment, we have nothing to add to that. That's just true. one thing I can say, though, is that this usual Wilsonian picture completely seems to erase, well, not completely, but in this usual Wilsonian picture, whether you're talking about a theory of scalars or gauge fields or gravity, none of it seems to matter. The basic way of organizing your way of thinking about quantum field theory as a Wilsonian is just by scale, right? At long distances compared to some scale, it'll be described by some effective field theory, at short distances by another one. But it doesn't much matter if it's scalars or gauge fields or gravity. It's the same kind of words you use for all of them. And also, in particular, there's not much difference between relativistic theories and non-relativistic theories. You know, there's detailed differences between how the scalings work and this and that. But the basic organizing principle is to organize physics by scale. This business shows there's something very, very special about relativistic theories. Okay? I mean, this is something that, as a high-energy physicist, there is always some high-energy triumphalism that there should be something very important about these relativistic theories. And it's always been a small source of disappointment for me as a devout Wilsonian, that distinction doesn't seem to be quite so important in that picture of the world. It's really important here. None of this magic happens for other theories. It's very important that it's spin one and gravity, it's spin two. And the reason is, it's when we get to these situations where the apparatus we need to describe it in a local way with quantum field theory forces the introduction of huge amounts of redundancy. It's really that, which is deeply tied into relativity, that's responsible for all the complexity from the usual point of view on the one hand, and on the flip side, all the simplicity from a dual point of view on the other hand. So it doesn't add anything extra to the understanding of renormalizability, but it does suggest that there is something very special about relativity. There's something very special about these theories that we study in high energy physics. They're not just different in detail from the kinds of systems that are observed in condensed matter. There's something more deeply different about them.
Thank you. Question?
So aren't we going to miss this nice trend of physics that the scales are separated and we don't need to care about, I mean, different scales at the same time in the modern language? I mean, the notion of effective field theory?
Well, so there's nothing wrong with the notion of effective field theory is true. It's correct. I should stress here, it's totally obvious, but let me just say it explicitly. No one is saying that the standard formalism of quantum field theory is wrong. Of course it's not wrong. I mean, it's exactly correct. It's our definition of the theory. It's the way we first ran into this structure, right? I mean, we discovered quantum mechanics, we discovered relativity, people put them together, quantum field theory is born, right? That's it. That's a theory we're studying. But the point is that what may be the case is that, you know, you like run into this big beast from one side and you think that the side of it that you saw is its most important defining feature. It's quantum mechanical, it's relativistic, right? But then you start walking around it and you see that, no, it's a much, 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 much bigger thing. And there are other angles that you might run into it where the quantum mechanics and relativity are not obvious at all. Other things are obvious, right? But the fact that that's true is very striking. It tells you that understanding these other ways of thinking about it might give you some clue for a way of talking about a system that really is quantum mechanical and really is local, but talking about it in a way that doesn't make such a heavy use of this idea. That's a lot like discovering the principle of least action that tells you a way of talking about deterministic physics without actually having it look particularly deterministic, even though it's just exactly the same system, right? So we've seen over and over again how important it is to find all the different ways of thinking about the thing that you have. Because it could be that the correct jumping off point for the next level theory isn't the one which you ran into at first step, but is one of these rewritings, as it was the case for quantum mechanics, right? The jumping off point from classical to quantum isn't F equals MA, it's a principle of least action. So we're just rewriting things. We're not changing anything, we're not losing anything, we're not gaining anything. In the sense of something new. There's no new phenomenon here. Well, there is something new that we can do. We can actually calculate the damn things. Okay, that is new. Okay, so that's, and so there's a check on what you're doing as well. Because, like I said, you have to calculate it, you have to check that it's local and unitary. If it isn't, you made a mistake. And you can't decide if the three-loop calculation is too hard that the answer is determined by the anthropic principle. Okay, there's some answer and you have to get it. So there's a check on how you proceed. But we're not changing anything. But if I can re-say your question, the question is, from this kind of point of view, could there be another way of understanding the Wilsonian way of thinking about field theory? See, this Wilsonian way of thinking about field theory is the place where the usual formalism of quantum field theory is at its strongest. That's where it's absolutely incredible to think about things in this local way. You think about physics locally, you imagine coarse graining to go to larger and larger distances, or you imagine integrating things out in momentum space. That is as local as you can get. And that very local way of thinking about it immediately explains the physics of the renormalization group. It immediately explains effective field theory. Immediately explains renormalizability. There's something very deep and very powerful about that Wilsonian way of thinking about quantum field theory. That's the, if you make locality as central to your thinking as you can, then you discover all of that as Wilson did, okay? So now there's an interesting question. How will all of that be reflected from this other point of view? Okay? So it can't be reflected in this way. It can't be so straightforward. Okay? Maybe this other point of view makes the scattering amplitudes very obvious, but the physics of the renormalization group has got to look more involved. It has to need some more structure. It's interesting that in the last 15 years, some people have found another way of talking about the renormalization group, which is not Wilson's way of talking about it, and which does involve some remarkable new kinds of mathematical structures. Alan Kahn and Dirk Kreimer and his colleagues since the mid-90s have been revisited the 1950s way of thinking about renormalizability using the BPHZ method and graphs and skeletons and trees and these horrible things in the back of textbooks that no one read. Other than a few experts, okay? They went back to that way, and no one read it except for a few experts, and then no one had to because Wilson gave us the correct way of thinking about it, okay? But they went back to this old way of thinking about it to try to understand better how it worked. And they found a nicer and cleaner way of saying how it worked that did involve some very interesting mathematical structures. There's a Hopf algebra structure that underlies the renormalization group. I should say that I mean, as a down-to-earth physicist, I didn't pay much attention to these developments because I thought, well, I don't need to know this. I know the correct way of thinking about it. It's Wilson's way. And so I don't need to learn all these fancy, I don't need to pay attention to this other way of thinking about it. But the fact that it exists now from this point of view is very intriguing, because it could be that in whatever the correct understanding is, that kind of structure will be needed to explain where the renormalization group comes from. It's also very interesting that the sorts of structures that they talk about are related to the ones that I'll tell you about tomorrow that seem to be underlying the physics of scattering amplitudes. So this is not a closed subject. It's the sort of beginning it's the beginning of something. But there's enough understood now that there's clearly something there, and that's what I will tell you more about tomorrow. Sir?
I could wait till tomorrow, but maybe just to provoke the discussion for those of us who are going to be tonight together at the dinner, the high-energy people. The main theme of your talks, important, crucial, is somehow to find the deep problems to work on, to define them, to concentrate, to proclaim them. And that's important, that's for sure. One of them is cosmological constant. We are all sure about that. The danger there, that you and I may run into it, and all of us here, is there may not be enough data to then check whatever brilliant ideas we come up with, because somehow doing great physics, as you know, it's not just the brilliance, intuition, whatnot, but also to be at the right time where the data can help you.
Sure.
So now what we had up to now was the standard model, right? I could argue that there are other deep issues, and I just want to provoke you whether you're going to mention that. For example, the standard model told us the neutrino was massless. I, for one, felt, and I kept fighting my friend Gia here, for example, who would argue with me just the way you do, that the hierarchy problem is the deep problem. I would argue, no, you don't have enough data. You may get lost there. Isn't the issue of what is the origin of neutrino mass and the breakdown of parity, which is the cornerstone of the standard model, one of the issues where it's full of data at the same time?
Yeah, I mean, there are lots of problems. There are many problems. There are many things that you could focus on as things that are mysterious.
I want your opinion.
I focus on the problems that I think are the most important. And when I say they're the most important, I mean I said this before. Look, anything correct about nature is important to find out. There's no doubt about that. Anything we learn is telling us something. But I think it is true that there are problems that have very natural solutions. They're not earth-shaking. The solutions don't completely change the way we think about the universe. Neutrino masses, I had a dimension 5 operator, I'm done. Okay, that's it. And furthermore, unfortunately, the real problem I have, it's not a problem, it's just a fact, that the neutrino masses are so small. Has a beautiful explanation because they can be, their dimension 5 operators can be suppressed by a high scale. And the real problem actually is that scale could be so high that we won't ever go there.
Sure.
Okay, it's a scale that's not so far from the gut scale, and that we just won't go there. That could be the explanation. But also, I mean, you're one of the people who was involved in understanding how this happens, and it's true that things look clearer afterwards than they did before. That's always the way things work. But when all is said and done, despite how confusing it was, despite the fact that it took great people to figure out that that's what it looks like, in the end, in our current understanding, it's a higher dimension operator that we add to the theory, one of many that could be there. And because it's also associated with such a high energy scale, you know, we may go there, we may not go there, but it doesn't sort of shake the foundations of physics, and it doesn't seem to be as mysterious a problem as the hierarchy problem, and especially the cosmological constant problem.
Sure.
Good problems have the really hard problems, which also perhaps are the ones that give us the deepest clue for how to proceed. Are the ones which it's not so easy to find solutions for them. I mean, and there aren't 17 solutions for them. Here, think of another one I didn't mention is the fermion mass hierarchy. This is another problem that I've spent a lot of time thinking about. Many people have spent a lot of time thinking about. My sense isn't that it's an important problem. It's a nice problem, but it's so easy to come up with solutions. There's lots and lots of solutions to this problem. And it doesn't seem that if you knew the answer, you would then know the answer to many, many other things. That's another feature of the questions that I chose to emphasize. They seem to be so important, not just because there's very few candidate answers. In the case of the hierarchy problem, very few. In the case of the cosmological constant problem, depending on how you count, none. Okay? Not because there are very few candidate answers, but because if any of those candidate answers were true, we would learn so much more about the way the world works than just the answer to that question. And that's another feature of I think, really, really profound questions in physics, is when you know the answer, you don't know just the answer to that question, but you know the answer to lots and lots of other questions. Oh, so I'm not denigrating, you know, it's not, I'm not denigrating the question of neutrino masses, but it doesn't seem to me to be at the
Well, same I was level. Curious about your opinion. Right. There we agree for sure on the cosmological constant, but I will repeat it once again. Anyway, just to discuss it tonight, the danger is there that you may lack data.
That is definitely true.
The reason I mentioned neutrino mass, I'm sorry, because I can't help mentioning it here, because it's studied by Salam. You see, the Salam that built was the first guy that wrote effectively how to have a left-handed wild fermion, you know, in 1957, and he'll be one of the fathers of the standard model, which was based on the absolute breakdown of parity. He will actually change his mind in the early 70s, would feel that the world ought to be left-right symmetric. Some of us that work this out, particularly Mohapatra and myself, actually came out with a prediction that neutrino was massive. I will mention this as an example that sometimes when you define great problems, the progress is happening, and it often happened. You know, when Dirac was writing his equation, it's not that everybody thought that it was the deepest problem in the world.
Yeah.
So, in fact, just to provoke the discussion.
I agree with that point so much that I will amplify it a little bit. It's very nice in lecture series like this. I mean, look, I'm not going to get up for five lectures and just say, this is what I was scribbling on my pad yesterday, and this is what I was thinking 3 weeks ago. So there was a point in trying to imagine what the important problems might be. But it is so true that the most important thing to do is to do non-trivial work. You know, you sit down, you have a well-defined problem. It seems that it's important, maybe not the most grandest important of all, but it's something, it's a little tough. You don't know how to proceed. You work, you find an answer. But the progress in physics happens like that so much. The way we teach the history to pretend that it's a sequence of delta functions surrounded by, you know, people doing grunt work in the middle is completely wrong. I mean, I cannot emphasize how wrong it is. In fact, I mean, there are great geniuses that come along every now and then and really clarify things. But normally, all those things happen in the middle of a lot of ferment that surrounds them. There's clearly something going on. It's not like there's nothing, oh, it's all crap, nothing. Oh, now it all makes sense. It's never been like that, okay? What works, and it's astonishing that it works. It's wonderful that it works. But it works. It's amazing that you just take one step after another, and you're climbing this mountain, and you go higher and higher and higher, and you know you're working. You know, you're sweating. You're, like, breathing hard. The altitude is getting thinner, okay? And you know something is going on. You know that there is something there. And you go, and a bunch of other people are going, okay, maybe like Mr. Newton Hiker then like runs up a little at the end and says, oh my God, there's this whole mountain range on the other side, and there's Hawaii, right? But it's never been the case that everyone is just sort of, you know, doing some crappy stuff, and then people come out from absolutely nowhere and take gigantic steps. This incremental path of progress works so spectacularly, it's shocking. It's shocking that people of limited talents, people like limited talents and capabilities, manage to make so much progress. And you know why? It's because we have a friend upstairs, and the friend upstairs is physics. We have to listen to what it's telling us and follow it. And if you do, no matter how talented you are, specifically, something will happen. And this collective efforts of the field make things happen. So I really want to stress this. I mean, it's true. It's great to think about these big questions as sort of inspiration for a general direction to head. But the most important thing, the absolute hardest thing in physics, is to figure out how to take these big airy-fairy ideas and turn them into something concrete to work on when you wake up in the morning every day. Okay? And the way to guarantee that you'll be able to do that, especially as students, is to, after these lectures, forget all about them, open your books, and do problems. Okay? Calculate things. Do all your problem sets. Do other people's problem sets. You know? Work really, really hard. Learn to be a good calculator, and good things only will happen from there. So I really thank you for making this point. Yeah.
And as you said, to think deeply. Look, what you said, Nima, which I appreciate a lot, to think deeply about whatever issue you want to think about. To think deeply, however, I can help to mention it, since we are talking about young people, that often means finding your own corner, which is away from other people are thinking about, and not what we defined as the problem. It's more likely that you find your own little discovery or a big discovery, okay? And
I think, well, we can have this discussion later too, but let me just say one last thing about this. This is sometimes true and sometimes not true. And I think it changes from case to case. There was a little bit too much establishment bashing, okay? There was a sense that sometimes that there is some cabal of a physics establishment that has some ideas that it pursues and it suffocates everyone else and you can't do anything else unless you follow what everyone else is doing. This isn't really true. First of all, no one stops you from doing whatever you want to do. That is the most important thing. The absolute most important thing is to have something that you want to do when you wake up in the morning and you want to do. Okay? And if you don't want to do it, it won't matter if the establishment wants you to do it or not. Okay? You won't do it. But I want to defend a little bit the idea of the physics establishment, because ideas come up, problems come up. That there are people with some thoughtfulness and who've thought about other problems, thought about these problems. If many people start focusing on a certain set of questions, it's not completely random. It's not a total accident that those are the questions that are being focused on. And there is an amazing track record of what the establishment does working. Okay? People really like to bash the establishment a lot. People especially like to bring Einstein up as this example of this incredible person out of left field who came in and did this incredible stuff. First of all, Einstein was pretty deep inside the academic establishment. One thing, the European academic system back then was very different than it is now. There weren't that many professorships. It wasn't so easy to do this as a living. He was well known to everyone. He was an outstanding student, and it didn't take him long to just get sucked right into it. He became as bourgeois a Berlin professor as you could possibly imagine very quickly when he invented GR. Okay? And secondly, an even better example is quantum mechanics, which is 10 times more revolutionary than relativity. Who invented quantum mechanics? Let's think. Is it possible to imagine a more suffocating, hierarchical, establishmentarian system than German academia in the early 1900s? Hard for me to imagine. Who invented quantum mechanics? Just think about it. Okay? It works. It works. And it's worked many times before. It works many times again. Are there cases where it doesn't work, where the lone rebels go off and find things? Sure. Okay, but it's just not the case that the boots of this establishment is on the throat of people who want to do alternative things. I mean, there's a reason why most people head off in some direction who think about something. They think it's going to pay off. And it has paid off many, many, many times in the past. It'll likely pay off many, many times in the future. I'm just saying, you know, think about things a little bit thoughtfully. And these sort of knee-jerk reactions aren't always the correct ones. I'm not saying that's what you're saying. I agree with what Goran said in spirit, certainly, that you should do what you want to do. But it's not true that everyone out there in pursuing some line are just a bunch of idiots who are following like sheep what a few leaders are saying. You know, all those people are also out there deciding what to do with the most precious thing that we all have, which is our time. Okay? So anyway, keep that in mind.
That's a perfect way to finish today's lecture. So let's thank Nima again.